Imagine you are a dinosaur living around Chicxulub, a town on the tip of the Yucatan Peninsula in present-day Mexico, some 66 million years ago. You are struggling to survive in everyday life, chasing prey, trying to escape predators, trying to protect your young. But when you least expect it, a bright flash appears in the sky, and from that moment on, your struggle for survival takes on a whole new meaning. Yes, I'm talking about the famous meteorite that wiped out the dinosaurs. This meteorite is thought to have a diameter of 10, 11 kilometers, but according to some calculations, it could be up to 81 kilometers. So we are talking about an incredibly large meteorite. Imagine that the meteor that fell on the Russian town of Chelyabinsk in 2013 had a diameter of only 20 meters, and yet around 1,500 people were injured, and around 7,200 people were injured, and around 7,200 buildings were damaged. The meteorite that wiped out the dinosaurs was 500 times bigger and weighed about 15 quadrillion kilograms, and it hit the Earth like a dagger. 99% of the energy released by the impact was scattered back into space, but that 1% energy caused the Earth to ring like a bell. The impact created a crater 150 kilometers in diameter and 30 kilometers deep. In fact, this is not the largest meteorite to hit the Earth that we have been able to record. An even larger meteorite, a gigantic one with a diameter of about 300 kilometers, fell in the vicinity of present-day South Africa some 2 billion years ago. But this meteorite, which formed the Chicxulub crater and would have wiped out the dinosaurs, is one of the best studied engines to date. An interesting point about this is that geological layers are covered over time by new depressions, and this Chicxulub crater was covered by about 600 meters of depressions from 66 million years ago until the 21st century. And yet it remains one of the best studied meteorites. Of course, one of the most critical things that will happen as a result of such a large meteorite impact is earthquakes. It is not even possible to imagine the earthquakes. It is not even possible to imagine the earthquakes at the point of impact. But let me give you an example. The seismic waves emitted from the impact point reached the west coast of what is now the United States in about 16 or 17 minutes, and over such a long distance, thousands of kilometers away, they caused earthquakes of about 11 or 12 magnitude. Imagine this earthquake like this. If you wanted to release that much energy artificially, you would have to detonate 500 billion of the atomic bombs dropped on Hiroshima at the exact same spot at the same time. 500 billion, that's right. Or, to put it in terms of the Tsar bomb, which those familiar with such nuclear bombs will know very well, if 100 million Tsar bombs were to be detonated at the same time, they would release energy equal to earthquakes a few thousand kilometers away. The Tsar bomb is the most powerful atomic bomb ever detonated by humanity, and 100 million of them need to be detonated. So we are talking about incredible energy. Of course, because of these huge earthquakes, many habitats were destroyed. As you can imagine, for example, rocks started falling on the dinosaurs living in the valleys. Those living in forests had branches falling on them, which was a big problem for small dinosaurs. Many habitats were destroyed just because of these earthquakes. Because the point where the meteorite fell was not a very deep point in the ocean, smaller tsunamis were generated, even though much bigger tsunamis could have been generated. But we still need to express this with the word mega tsunami, because it is calculated that waves exceeding 100 meters were generated. According to some studies conducted in the near future, the height of these mega tsunamis may have reached 1.4 kilometers, so it could reach 1,400 meters. But if, for example, it had fallen into a deeper part of the ocean, it could have created mega tsunamis of 4-5 kilometers. The waves were so high that dinosaurs, and not only dinosaurs, but all life that lived on the shore, had to face, and you can imagine the devastation. And you can imagine the devastation. Another effect of the impact was, of course, on the atmosphere. Because such a high pressure spread around, winds of over 1,000 kilometers per hour were generated. So whatever was in the air around the impact site at the time had to crash to the ground. Of course, a lot of geological events were triggered by this impact, so we see that tectonic activities were triggered. For example, volcanoes all over the world were triggered by the impact and the earth shaking like a bell, and they started spewing lava all around. Of course, around the impact point, depending on the intensity of the impact, the earth's crust shifted and scattered around, and all the forests in the vicinity started to burn. This meant the end of many species living in those habitats. Another problem was that the dust and smoke from the impact started to cover the atmosphere, so they cut off the sun's rays, and most of the photosynthetic organisms living on the Earth had to perish, unable to photosynthesize, or doing so in a much more limited way. You can imagine the effect on the food chain. Countless ecological chains have been upset, and many lives have perished just because of this coating effect. There is also the greenhouse gas effect, as we know from today's climate change. The sun's rays that were able to reach the Earth were trapped in the atmosphere as a result of the thick coating of the atmospheric layer with gases, dust, and smoke, and the surface temperature of our planet began to increase rapidly. This caused many of the problems we experience today due to climate change to affect the creatures that lived at that time in a much shorter period of time. It is thought that it takes about 10 years for the dust and smoke from the shield to reach the ground again, and the high temperatures during this process cause the extinction of many cold-blooded animals. Of course, we also need to talk about toxic gases, because many gases trapped under the crust of the planet's Earth start to come to the surface with the effect of this vibration and volcanism. I'm talking about carbon monoxide, sulfate, methane, and many other gases. For example, since carbon monoxide is a heavier gas than air, where this gas comes out, carbon monoxide layers of several meters are formed on the surface of the Earth, and many animals that do not have a certain length die by suffocation and poison. So we are talking about a very chaotic period. Let's take sulfate, for example. The sulfate that comes to the surface not only has a greenhouse gas effect, but also causes acid rain. All of a sudden, acid starts raining down on you, and you die because of this acid, regardless of your size. We're talking about such a chaotic process when we look at the events caused by this impact. Both because of the gases emitted by the impact and because of this acid rain, a very serious ecological destruction begins in the ocean. We see ocean acidification at a level that will cause the extinction of many fish, reefs, and other ocean life. One of the biggest problems of climate change today is the increase in the accumulation of gases such as carbon dioxide in the oceans, which in turn acidifies the ocean and disrupts life cycles. As you can imagine, this series of events causes life at that time to have to face these problems for hundreds or even thousands of years. Because of all these events, which are only due to the impact of the impact, most of the creatures weighing over 25 kilograms, especially the cold-blooded animals, disappeared. And so we see that a large part of the group we call dinosaurs disappeared. Only one branch in particular survived this process. They are the class of creatures we know today as birds. Birds are direct descendants of dinosaurs, and they still represent dinosaurs today. Apart from them, we see that all other dinosaurs have been wiped out both by the direct impact of the impact of the impact, and by this climate change. But when we talk about this extinction, sometimes we focus too much on dinosaurs, because dinosaurs were not the only species, the only group of living things that disappeared. We see that mammals, insects, birds, marine life, flying reptiles, such as pterosaurs, all or most of them disappeared. Numerically speaking, 3 out of every 4 species that lived at that time were unfortunately wiped out by this meteorite and the events that followed. But that's a little bit what the history of evolution is like. So there have been many such catastrophes in the history of evolution. At least 5 of them we know very clearly. And it is thought that we are in the midst of a 6th human-caused extinction. And the one that happened 66 million years ago is not even the deadliest extinction that has ever happened. If you think about the Permian-Triassic extinction, for example, 90% of all species that lived at that time were wiped out. But every extinction makes evolutionary new beginnings possible. So, as you all probably know very well, the rise of mammals was made possible by the extinction of the dinosaurs. Because dinosaurs were a very serious limiting factor for mammals, Mammals had very serious predators when dinosaurs were alive. But with their disappearance, mammals found new habitats and began to diversify very quickly. The surnames that will go to whales, bats, and primates have undergone a very serious evolutionary spread. We call this adaptive radiation. Geologically, these are periods of very serious diversification in relatively short periods of time. This extinction 66 million years ago is one of the best examples of this. A small group of rodents that split off from mammals evolved into a group that would later be called primates. And 60 million years after that extinction, another split within primates made possible the line of descent that would lead to us humans, who we know today as Homo sapiens. So, sometimes when we look back at the history of evolution, thinking about whether we would be here or under what conditions we would be living if this event hadn't happened is a very interesting thought process, and one that often leads us to very unrealistic conclusions. In general, as you can see from this account, the history of evolution is like the history of extinctions. But life knows how to find its way one way or another. And if we keep wasting our planet in this way, the world will get rid of us like a dog out of its pit. Maybe 75s, 80s, 80s, 90s of the species will disappear because of us, and we are rapidly on that path. But that extinction will take its place in geological history, in the history of evolution, just like any other extinction, and we hope that life will find its way again. See you in the next video. Goodbye.